So what brings you back from the dead?
A week ago, I did a job. A bounty. I had a partner, believe it or not.
He know what you used to be? Will I ever see you again?
They tried to kill me, Anna. If you need to find me, I go by Spike Spiegel these days. In this solar system, if the cops and the bounty hunters don't get you, the syndicate will. There's no happy ending here.
Spoken like a man who's never been in love.
I was.
What happened?
I was dreaming.
What do you say, fellas? You want to team up? I was thinking a 60-40 split. Going my way, of course.
Do not shoot her.
Please?
No.
What the actual fuck?
We're a team. The three of us. Go grab some bounties.
Please, I just want to kill her a little bit.
God damn it, Spike. It's jam.
Good guys. Or bad guys.
Depends on who you ask.
Boom, there you go. The trailer for Cowboy Bebop streaming on Netflix today, guys. And as you'll see from the first episode, this amazing first bounty for the team, and also a good friend. He's an amazing actor. He's been killing it for a long time in the industry. I can't wait to have like an even longer conversation with him. But right now, I just wanted to get a few words for him with him about this new show that everybody's been anticipating because the anime has been loved by so many for so long. So I'm just super excited for my man participating in this film, being the first bounty. He plays Reggie Tanaka, my man, James Hiroyuki Liao. Right out. I'm shooting off air horns right now. You're going to hear it in post. So I didn't want to deafen you, but we're celebrating you. We're giving you your flowers. I'm so excited for you, dude, with this film now and showcasing you out the rip, bro. Because you got the first lines of dialogue as we get into the series. And I think I told you earlier when I started binging it, when Netflix first sent it to me, I was just like, my man killed it. You set the tone. You set the theme for all the characters to start doing their thing. I loved it, man. Bravo, bro. Bravo.
You, thanks so much, Kuya P. Yo, thanks so much for asking me. And yeah, you know, you never know how things edit out. So it was kind of cool. I got an email from John Cho too, you know, saying that pretty much the opening sequence was kept intact and everything, and congratulated. It was such an awesome gesture on his part. And then that was pretty much confirmed when you told me also, because you got to see a screening much earlier than the rest of us. So it's such an honor to say the first lines of a brand new series, you know, even though it's not brand new. You know, this is what I want to say first off, just as a generality for the show. Please keep an open mind, guys. I know there's a lot of Bebop fans out there that love the anime and didn't want it touched. I know I'm biased because I'm in it, you know, albeit for this much of it. But they really, really went on a mission to honor and to have the world's match. So if you saw the anime, you're not going to all of a sudden see just character names that have nothing to do with, because, you know, a lot of adaptations of animes and other things, you know, the disappointment, I think, a lot of time has been, well, you took a bunch of character names, but you didn't have the style, the feel, the look, the ethnicities, right? and all of that. And I think that you're gonna find with some new twists and definitely some new takes on things, but you're gonna be in the world of Bebop. That was the coolest thing. I know I'm being biased, but I'm telling you, as far as adaptations go, I have not seen anything like this where it really pays homage to the original. So I'm really excited for everybody to check it out. And it was one of the greatest experiences of my life, not just as an actor, but as a human being. No other opportunity like this could have allowed me to go out to New Zealand, where I worked with and met some of the most gracious, kindest spiritual people I've ever met in maybe the most beautiful place I've ever seen in the world. It was unreal. It was an unreal experience, and I would do it again in a heartbeat. I wish my part was bigger, but you know, I tried to make the most out of it. And the cast is incredible. Everyone was just—it was just such an amazing experience.
I love that. I love that. And I want to add to that, and actually go a little bit more with some questions. But because of you making that comment, I just want to add a little bit more because, again, you wanted to show respect to the fans right now. That again, that maybe the true diehards in anime, and so that to me just shows how gracious you are as an actor, as well as the rest of the cast and the people behind this. I came into it as a non-anime guy, you know. And you're part of another Asian org that I'm with, the APOC. Shout out to APOC with Denise. But like for me as an Asian, you know, we get a lot of stereotypes. And so one of the stereotypes for me growing up was like anime manga, that we had to know that just because we're Asian. I'm like, no. And so I kind of resisted it. So I'm sorry. Long story short, I came to this not knowing the anime. I was aware of it, had an appreciation for the art style of it, but because of racism and stereotypes, I didn't jump into it initially because, you know, I want to defy that. You know what I'm saying? We're not a monolith. So
right. When
I finally checked it out, as I told you, and as I hit you up, when I saw your face come across my screen, and actually the first things was your words. And I got to give you a shout. I got to do this real quick. Shitbag corporations. They own everything now. Food, medicine, fuel.
It was not hard to act that line. It was not hard to act, you know. Yeah. You know, so just as an actor,
yeah, knowing like, you, I'm sure that wasn't hard to do.
When you're getting into the roles and stuff, like, you know, with everything you do, regardless of what it is, you know, you understand you might be in something that might be more entertaining in some jobs. You know, you know, I know I'm not saving whales or I'm not curing cancer and whatever. And yet, you know, and every actor has their own way into this. But for me, I'm always trying to find the similarities. I'm always trying to find the thing that makes me believe that I can say this person's words, that common thread, the things that I actually give a damn about, you know, I mean,
I love
when my values, when my values, my actual values, who I am, what I care about match up, with what I believe, you know, a character's, values are, I'm always going to be more right for it then. And in this case, even though, yes, on the face of it, oh, he's a thug. Oh, he's a bad guy. That's the general surface of it all. But we don't know his backstory. So exactly. For me, I had a backstory that was pretty damn tragic. So when he says the first lines of the show, you know, spoiler, guys. No, but it's going to come out at the same time. Right. So shitbag corporations. There's a lot of meaning behind that about what these greedy, hyper corporations have done, not only to his community but to him personally, in terms of what they've taken away. And so when I broke it down personal like that, then it's a lot easier playing somebody, because now you feel like you can walk in their shoes. And I definitely have a lot of experiences of that in my life. So it was a wonderful thing. One thing I do want to say to the fans out there, there's not going to be like a one-to-one. Like the episodes of Bebop are not going to be like, oh, it's exactly the same as an episode of the anime. Okay, they're going to take bits and pieces. You're going to see some villains, you know, that you'll recognize. But my character actually did not make it into the anime series. There was a very, I don't know if a lot of you have seen it. You can't see it now because they've taken it down everywhere. But there was a film Cowboy Bebop animated that wasn't received as well as the original cartoon. you know, same people behind it and everything, but it was a film. It wasn't the series, the animated, and my guy Tanaka was in that one. So, you know, they took my character, you know, well, my character that it's based off of, out of that one, and then put it right into the teaser of the first episode. So, you know, just don't expect all the episodes to just match up with what an episode of the anime was. You know, they're going to take bits and pieces and kind of corral things in a really unique and special way. I've really not seen anything like this. You know, it's really, really cool.
Oh, that's amazing. That's a great nugget. Now you're going to have me digging to find that, James. I'm going to look for that. But again, when I heard those lines and then your face came across my scene and just, bro, again, you're a friend and just seeing as an actor and knowing you, you chewed up that scenery. You stole that, man. I loved everything about it. So again, bravo. But going back to what you're saying, and as you continue to say, to again, let the fans know, again, it's not a one-to-one direct from the anime. There's, and as you stated, there's a lot of heart. And from me, as I was telling you, I came into it as a non-anime guy, not knowing Cowboy Bebop, fell in love with it. I'm now going back, checking out the anime and seeing how dedicated they were, especially in the first episode with translating a lot of the scenes, panel to panel in a way. Well, I'm going manga, but like shot selections, like when certain things happened in like that first episode with I'm forgetting the character's name, but like when the belly gets shot through the very end, when they're right, when they get killed in space, just some of the amazing iconography from the anime to the live action. But I wanted to tell you, so like not long after I binged it, enjoyed it, I brought in a good friend of mine who's the biggest Cowboy Bebop fan. So I wanted to get that opinion, you know, to see if one of the big Cowboy fans would really appreciate it. And she did. She obviously did point out some of the things that were different. And that made it interesting for me to get that perspective. But overall, she truly enjoyed it. And like I, after we did like the first three, she came back like not too long. And like I let her finish out the series just so she could help me do more reviews on the show. She's ready for a season two. And, you know, and since you're on here, as you said, you only get that little first part because you get to lock up. Jet Black sends you back to jail later on in the episode. But that means you could still come back, though. You know, yes, you're in jail, but we see also how shady the cops are in the series, especially when we see Jet Black's story in like episode 6 or 7. I can't recall. So there's a chance, and I'm praying for my man to come through.
Yo, from your mouth to God's ears, brother. You know, I don't care if it's a billion to one chance. I don't care if they want me to come back as an alien in full, you know, Klingon outfit or whatever the freak. I would love to be on Bebop again. What a special experience. What a special, incredible for any actor that's out there. My God, I wish for them experiences like these. It's incredible. The one thing that I want to say, that's something that's on my mind, Kuya P. If I can just go off on a little tangent here that I think it's
hell important. Yeah, brother. Hell yeah.
Important. It's important for me to say, because I know that a lot of probably other Asian American actors or just Asian American activists or whoever. And even if you're not, this applies to all of us. But, you know, I just want to say this, guys, that frigate 15, 20. I mean, forget it. And then after that, but 15, 20 years ago. You know, I don't want to say there's not a chance, but no, man, let's be freaking real.
Hell yeah.
There's no chance that Spike Spiegel is being played by an Asian American. And even though, you know, you might say, well, you know, they switched some of the ethnicity, some of the characters, but, you know, I'm so proud of this show because, you know, and maybe, you know, we shouldn't be like, oh, well, great, because I don't want to be ever in acceptance of second-class citizenry ever. So we should have been able, Asian people should have been able to portray Asians 15, 20, 25, 30 years ago. That didn't happen. And even recently, it still happens when that doesn't happen. But in this, they got the right guy for it. John Cho is exceptional in this. He deserves this. And as a community, we really do too. And so, you know, if this thing were not so good, or if it was degrading, or in any of those. And I know we're not monolithic, so we all have different opinions and boundaries about what's acceptable and what's not. But I full-heartedly, not just because I'm in it, but believe that this is so important to have John Cho, an Asian American, doing this role so well, because now little boys and little girls too can look at and say, hey, there's a hero. Look at Shang-Chi. Oh my goodness. That superhero looks like me. It's so important. I grew up, just to be a little personal side tangent, I grew up in a very non-Asian neighborhood when I was a kid. And the effects of that, I'm not going to blame it all on my community, but I definitely grew up with a sense of feeling like a second-class citizen for a long period of my life. And I even catch myself now accepting the unacceptable. And I catch myself saying, no, James, that's bullshit. Don't do it. I don't know what we can say language wise. So excuse me if that's
it's all good, brother.
But so it's very, very important. Yes, it's Cowboy Bebop, it's action and all these things, but there is a big social significance to this as well. So, you know, so keep an open mind, guys, and really do support it, because it's worth supporting.
I love it. My man, James, dropping the knowledge. Real talk, speaking for all of us. And I can't thank you enough for that, man. So, yeah, let's talk about a little bit of the work that you put down under in New Zealand. What was it like on set with Mustafa and John and Cho, you know, when you're dangling a little bit, you know, in a special scene, you know, how'd that go down?
When the disruptor blows this guy, this awesome dude named Billy, he played Frank, and he shoots a hole right through the, and you know, and it's cool, right? Because that's when you realize, oh shit. I mean, you know, I think there's actually a scene before that where you realize they're in a ship, you know, because it just looks like a 70s casino, right?
Oh yeah. It looks amazing. It looks amazing.
Yeah. When he blows the hole through it. So so they totally had this enormous fan blowing, right? And then they had us on harnesses, you know, which obviously they can edit out now, but you know, a lot of that we sort of kind of had to really tighten up and try to be as straight as possible, even though we were on a harness and so we were having help. You know, and kind of really, really, acting the G forces that were hitting us, right? Because I could have just very easily let my legs drop, John Cho too. And man, you know, I'm not gonna lie, I wasn't in the best shape. And I was like, I remember one take, I was totally fucking around, but I went, let's shoot this fucking thing already, because I haven't exercised. Keep my body as straight as possible. And it, you know, but it was so much fun. It was so much fun. You know, the stunt team, really, really cool. Not to knock anybody out here, not to make comparisons, but it was this kind of, just from the first day, the stunt guys that worked with us and everything, when they everybody greet each other good morning with a hug. And they would say, oh, kia ora, brother. You know, kia ora is this greeting in the Maori language of the indigenous people of New Zealand and everything. And there was just this like family atmosphere from the word go, right? And that's awesome. And you know, because I guess it's a pilot and they really, really want to get it right, you know, they had us all together for a long time before we start shooting. I mean, John Cho, Mustafa, Alex, and Danielle, they had been there for a long, long time, even before I got there. Then I was in the stunt gym for about 2.5, almost 3 weeks before I started shooting. And so we really did get to know each other in kind of like as a group ensemble, almost like you were actors in a play, right? And that's a unique experience on camera, because most jobs, you're going to meet somebody who's playing your wife or your girl, or whatever, like the day of, you know, right before they call action is like the first time you meet them. And so in this, it was really, really built, step by step by step, and was really like a family atmosphere. I mean, talking to Mus and talk Mustafa, I call him Mus. I mean, was like talking to like a brother from another mother, you know. Jan, who plays Asimov in this main bad guy, and all the fans of Bebop will know Asimov because that was a really cool character, right? In the first episode of the anime. Yeah. He plays, he's amazing, and he's just an amazing human being. He's my friend today. We hang out, you know, when I'm back in LA, and so it really did create such a family atmosphere, and kind of the culture, at least of, you know, what little I experienced in New Zealand while I was there, it did very much seem from the moment you step off the plane that these are some of the friendliest people you will ever meet in your life. And I got along, like, I call it Team Casino because my part is really just in the casino.
Yeah.
So all these people that were in the casino with, I'm still emailing them. I'm still talking to them. And, you know, and I consider them friends now. So, you know, it was really an amazing experience. New Zealand actors are awesome, man. I mean, my God, when you talk about no pretension, no ego, and just, I mean, giving it, bringing it 1,000,000% every take on it. Johnny on the spot. Man, I mean, I loved it. Loved these cats. Loved all of them.
That's absolutely wonderful. You love to see that. As an actor, filmmaker, you know what we do. That's just beautiful to hear and see, brother. I'm so happy for you, man. Again, I was thrilled as I watched it. And knowing you and then the lines you got to deliver, you got to chew that up. And just, again, I see no reason not to be able to bring Tanaka back. If not, I'm going to take him out to the woods, brother, and the woods will be set on fire. Because, again, I need you back in there, brother. You killed it. What, you know, to just leave out, because I know you got a lot of things going on, and I don't want to keep you too long. But the reception, I'm sure you've seen a little bit online. Did you go to the premiere? And what was the vibe with the rest of, like, the cast and crew? Any talk, if this goes well, that there could be a season two or anything that you might be able to know? Give me a little knowledge on.
You know, listen, like, you know, my part is like, you know, like I said, you know, I'm not a big part of the show. And I, you know, I just have a guest role in the very first episode. So, I don't have any insider info whatsoever, but I would be really shocked, you know, I mean, you never know in this business, right? But I would be really shocked if there wasn't a season two, Kuya P, because again, I think this show I think a lot of fans, a lot of diehard fans, will be very pleasantly surprised. I hope they really, really do embrace it, because I think a lot of care was taken to really pay homage and pay respects and to be in the same world, right? It's not just about, oh, we want you to remind you of the anime, but you want to be in that same world, you know? For all the science fiction action and all the cool stuff about it, right? The clash of worlds, like a 70s style, a 70s look, rundown cars, and then spaceships, right? And all that stuff. And there's all these cool things like the syndicate and all these different bad guys. But at the end of the day, when you really, really look at it, right, it is another classic story about power struggle, right? And who has the power and who doesn't. And the original anime had that in spades too. This is not a story about kings and queens and emperors, who go to war with each other, you know, in some kind of like dynastic type of thing. This is a world that's been torn apart, an earth that's fractured, people that are super, 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 super poor and struggling, and then those who control the power. And how sometimes, you know, even in your own job, as you have to feed your family, as these bounty hunters do, you know, I think there is a moral question that comes up of, you know, in the service of myself, because I got to eat, am I also being part of the problem, right? Because I'm being fed by the powers that oppress these people, that turn them to desperate situations that may lead them to crime. I think that's really relevant for today. So because it's so relevant, I think even if you've never seen the anime, there's something in this for you, okay? It really, really is unlike anything else that I think is on Netflix or even TV. So please give it a shot. And for those reasons, I just by myself fully believe in a season two. But of course, I'm not privy to any of that. So I don't know, man. Your guess is as good as mine.
It's going to happen. I'm manifesting it right now, brother.
Yeah,
I'm
man. Manifest
it. It's going to happen.
Absolutely.
And as I told you, man, as a non-fan that didn't come into it with anything, it grabs me. I'm now a fan and I'm checking out the anime. And like I told you, I brought in the super anime fan that was all about that. She came in and appreciated it and she's all about it. And I'm sure that's going to be the same. If you weren't a fan, it's going to get new fans. I think there's a lot to work with there. It was a fun ride. I truly enjoyed myself from episode 1 to episode 10. And on a filmmaking standpoint,
I'm looking forward to seeing him with everybody else. So,
man, I can't wait for you to get that. Because again, as I was getting ready to say, when I saw episode 1 from a filmmaking standpoint, as a producer and for the casting directors, when they see your performance, brother, I got to say this to you because I have you on now because you deserve these flowers. You absolutely killed it. That opening sequence, again, I can't say it enough. Set the tone, got you on that ride. You gave face, your interactions with everybody running that crew, outstanding. If that doesn't tell, if y'all don't know about James Hiroyuki Liao, you know him now. Tanaka, he killed it. Hire this brother, give him everything. I need to see you in more shit. If whether or not come back as Tanaka, I need you in more work, man. You need more work because you're an amazing performer, brother.
In that WP, if I can do a little shameless self-promotion here. I don't know when it's going to come out. Probably early next year or you know, spring of next year, hopefully. But there is a 8-episode miniseries by Hulu about Elizabeth Holmes, who's on trial right now.
Yeah.
So obviously it's not about the trial. It's about everything leading up to that. I've got a part in it as Elizabeth Holmes, original head engineer, first engineer at Theranos. And so that's going to come out next year. And I've got some other things that I'm doing, but I'm under a very, 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 very strict non-disclosure agreement, so can't talk about it. But there's some other really, really cool stuff that's going to happen next year. Man. So check out. It's going to be called The Dropout. The Dropout on Hulu, about Elizabeth Holmes, based off of the Dropout podcast. Which is a fascinating podcast too. That was about this whole thing with Elizabeth Holmes and everything. So. I'm going to be on that for 2 episodes, 2 out of the 8, in the miniseries that's coming out next year. And I'm super, super, super proud of it too. I think it was one of the most incredible casts that I probably have worked with in my entire career. And, it's been such a blessing. You know, anytime you get work, in this business, it's so hard to come by that, it really is all a blessing. And so for any young actors out there that might be listening, might be watching, listen, it is really a marathon. That's not a cliche. It's the truth. And when you do get a yes, just remember and hold on to the fact that you did get a yes. And if you did get a yes, you can get a yes again, no matter how much time there may be in between. If you get a yes, you can get a yes again. So don't be discouraged. Don't get down on yourself. Know yourself. Know yourself. Know your worth. Know your value. And don't ever, ever, ever base it on how big your paycheck is or how big you think this part is. It's a marathon. It's a process. Okay? So stay the course. Stay the fight.
My man, this is why I love this guy. Yeah. Just his talent shows through, as you'll see. When you watch episode 1, as you'll see in The Dropout, give this brother more work. I can't wait to see him more. I can't wait to hopefully collaborate with him on something, but just so extremely talented. I'd ask you to give your socials, James, but I know you ain't really up on the socials like that. So just.
Oh, yeah. No, I'm one of these really old school dudes. Dude, I mean, I literally, when everyone in America had a cell phone. I still didn't. Then I was forced to get one by my agents. And my first cell phone was a flip phone that had no internet. You can only call and text. And so now I finally do have an iPhone that needs to be retired, because I think I'm still the only person in America with an iPhone 5. But it does get internet on it and stuff. So yeah, man, I've never been on Facebook. I've never been on Twitter, Instagram, or any of those things. So unfortunately, I'm not keyed in on all of those things, but I am aware that those things exist.
Well, I'm forecasting the future, because again, I'm putting it out into the universe that I need more of you killing it on screen. So you're going to have an assistant to handle all that. Your assistant's going to bring you the Zoom, the phone. They're going to have everything ready, so that way we could just be amazed.
Not the way I roll, brother. I'm just a working class kid from Brooklyn, man.
My God. See, I love this guy. James, bro, thank you. Thank you. I can't wait for the world to see this. It's out now, y'all. It's streaming on Netflix. Check it out. And then, man, give my man some flowers. And I look forward to seeing on The Dropout. And then hopefully with all the other projects, too, that you can't talk about. But when you can, come through.
I can't talk about it. I'm not supposed to.
But when you can, we'll get into it and we'll have some fun.
All right.
My brother, so excited to have you and so happy for you, man.
One love, everybody. One love to everybody out there. Thanks for supporting and keep fighting the good fight, guys. Keep fighting the good fight.
There we go. That's my brother, James Liao. Check him out. Cowboy Bebop, Tanaka in the house, your boy Kuya P, NRW, we're nerds, rule the world. We are out of here, guys. There you go.